our song, we say to welcome our guests. Come on, y'all sing it. Glad you came.
Glad you came to be a part of our fellowship.
To experience this awesome move of God.
For something meaningful and life-changing to help you move through the challenges of life? Then join Bishop John A. McCullough II and the Friendship Christian Church of Gastonia for an inspirational message prepared just for you.
Chapter number 40. Isaiah chapter number 40. Glory to God. Good to see everybody today. Invite somebody to worship even now. Isaiah chapter number 40. Today I'm going to read from the Amplified Version. And go to verse 27. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 27. Is where we will begin. Why, O Jacob, do you say and declare, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and the justice due me escapes the notice of my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become tired or grow weary. There is no searching of his understanding. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who has no might, he increases power. Even youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly. But those who wait for the Lord, who expect, look for, and hope in, will gain new strength and renew their power. They will lift up their wings and rise up close to God like eagles rising toward the sun. They will run and not become weary. They will walk and not grow tired. Is that the essence of what your Bible says today? I want to talk about a vaccine for the weary. A vaccine for the weary. Y'all gonna help me today? Put that in your comment section. A vaccine for the weary. We just finished celebrating Christmas. And in my 63 years, I would never have imagined that we would have experienced a Christmas season like the one of 2020. My God, I mean, you know, we were everything but on lockdown. We've been in masks. They've asked people not to gather into large of groups, and many churches had to cancel their Christmas cantatas and celebrations, and so we never would have imagined. In fact, who would have thought about it that we would have experienced a year like 2020? The pandemic has caused weariness. To mask or not to mask has become a political issue and has caused some weariness. Now, when we think about being weary, we're thinking about not in terms where you're just totally out of it. You're tired. You're maybe exhausted and so forth. When you think about weariness, you have not totally dropped out, but there is some tiredness that's going on. When things continue and persist, it causes weariness, and so the pandemic has done that, and we have the debate as to whether to believe that COVID-19 is a hoax or if it's real. It has caused some weariness in people. The pandemic has caused some anxiety and some fear and some frustration, and the result is weariness. Hospitals are overwhelmed. Frontline workers have become weary. Long hours and seeing patients not make it has produced weariness. And then to see the kind of way this country has been divided by race, divided by religion, divided by conservative and liberal parties, it has caused some weariness in people. The election 2020 and the accusation of fraud has caused weariness. To see the efforts of those in governmental leadership essentially try to disenfranchise African American votes in some battleground states has caused a bit of weariness. To see shutdowns and layoffs and businesses close and unemployment benefit delays and to see and know we have a government that does not balk at the giving tax cuts to the wealthy, and even if it blows up the deficit, but they hiccup on providing aid to people who are not wealthy, and it has produced some weariness. And then we have those who accuse you if you're in food lines or looking to our country where working people pay taxes, and to have people to respond to you and to tell you that you're just looking for a handout when you look for a stimulus check. When the people did not cause COVID-19 and the people did not cause the lockdown, all of this has caused some weariness. It has caused weariness on marriages and weariness in families and weariness in school students and weariness in college students and athletes in middle school, high school, and college. This has been a year like no other year. I mean, my God, we have seen volatility in the job market before. We have seen racism at many levels before. We have seen economic declines before. Yes, and we understand that we have seen diseases before, but it is seldom that we see all of it in the same year like we have seen in 2020. As it relates to the COVID-19, the excitement and the relief came as a vaccine was announced and one that would provide a defense against the impact of coronavirus. And many have already taken it. And the goal is for the whole country to take the vaccine, and some have already done it, and they've already started to receive the results and so forth. There are some now who are a little anxious about making the decision to take the vaccine. And when you think about it, the research says vaccines and vaccinations currently save between 2 and 3 million lives every year. Vaccines as public health tools eradicating smallpox and containing polio to just 3 endemic countries and greatly reducing many other diseases. And so it has a good track record. But the reality is there are many who are so weary about it all in 2020. And you got to recognize that if you're going to do the vaccine, it becomes a personal and individual decision. The weariness is on the part of believers and unbelievers. There's weariness in blacks and whites and Hispanics and Asians. There's weariness in Republicans and Democrats and the young and the old and the rich and the poor. And as it relates to, you know, how we move forward in this year and how we conclude this year where there has been much weariness, we got to recognize that there is a vaccine for the weary. There is a part of philosophical thought called existentialism, and it has to do with our existence, and it suggests that human existence is not totally describable or even understandable in any capacity. It takes the things that we experience and tries to make sense out of it all, looking for truth through logical reasonings and always trying to understand who we are and how we exist. In existentialism, there are questions that are raised, questions like, what is truth? And are we really free? And I want to tell us today, you got to be careful in raising questions and from where you get your answers. Yeah, we get our truth as believers from the Word of God. Do I have anybody? Now, when we think about the weary, there are weary saints, and the weary saint has to deal with a degree of sadness. And the existentialist says that when you want something which you cannot have, then you might become frustrated or angry or even grow weary. You might feel unfairly treated or just downright unlucky. But if you used to have and you can't have it any longer, then you might become even more sad and more weary. Yes, ordinary lives are full of both and these absences and the things that we cannot have and the things we used to have and we have lost, things like people and objects and other intangibles like belief or status or a sense of belonging. There is then a sense of sadness and disappointment and weariness in the people. And that was what was happening with the people in the text that I read into your hearing. Over in Isaiah chapter number 40, the people knew what it was like to have lived in freedom in their homeland, and now they were experiencing bondage in Babylonian captivity. They were weary and they were ready to lose their hope. And seeing what we are experiencing in 2020 is a time where there is great weight upon people, and people are frustrated and aggravated, and some are even about to lose hope on this last Sunday in 2020. It's one thing to go through something, but when you feel like while you're going through it that you have been abandoned by God, it's even worse. Can I get a witness? I mean, come on, we all go through something, and as long as we sense that God is right by our side, we feel pretty good. But when you come to that place and where when you're going through and you're beginning to feel weary, and then you begin to feel and sense the absence of God, it becomes more intense. Whenever you are tired physically and emotionally and spiritually, you have to be very careful, and because you are not as sharp, and you are not thinking as clearly as before, you are not as discerning, you may not use wisdom during that time. And I see this in the text, that these were weary people. They had not totally zonked out, but they had become exhausted. They had become tired, like many of you under the sound of my voice today. Everybody will go through something sometime and for various reasons, but we all can grow weary, and we can all become exhausted because of what we are dealing with. And so as you are dealing with possibly growing weary, the first thing I want to tell you this morning is that don't develop a misconstrued understanding of God. Don't develop a misconstrued understanding of God. To misconstrue is to interpret wrongly. It's to analyze incorrectly. And that's when you're tired, and that's when you're weary, and you got to be careful in making decisions and responses and statements during these times. Look over again at verse number 27. The prophet begins to query the people. He had picked up on what they had begun to say. And the Holy Ghost has picked up on what people have begun to say in 2020. And so the prophet comes to the people there, and he says, "Why, O Jacob, do you say and declare, O Israel, that my way is hidden from the Lord?" Why are you saying things like this? Why are you saying, "And the justice due me escapes the notice of my God"? He wants to know. The prophet was curious as to how they came to suggest that their situation was hidden from God. And he asked Jacob, he asked Israel, and this was language that showed that there was divine covenant with God when he called them God's people. And here they are, they were attempting to bring God down to their human level his being forgetful and unaware. No, he is omniscient. He knows all things, and he sees all things. And aren't you glad that he is there? He knows what you're going through right now. He knows the challenges that you have right now. He knows how frustrated and weary you are right now. Why are you saying, "I don't believe God sees me. I don't believe God knows where I am"? It looks like he's blessing other people. It looks like he's intervening in somebody else's situation, but it looks like he had left me all alone to fend for myself. And I want to encourage somebody today to understand, don't bring God down to your human level. I don't care how weary you become, don't ever misconstrue who God is. Yeah, and try to characterize him as being forgetful and unaware. You see, when you have been dealing with something for any length of time, it'll begin to paralyze your vision. There are some folk that came in the 2020 excited about vision 2020, seeing what God was going to do. But as the year progressed, and here you are on the last Sunday in the year, this thing has caused you now to forget about what you've been speaking previously. It's caused you to forget about the vision and the dream that you have had before. It's paralyzed your vision. It will only allow you to see what is not or what has not yet happened, and you will identify your destiny with your present reality. But I want to encourage somebody right now to understand that, chill a minute, because listen, I don't know what you're experiencing, but your destiny is not wrapped up in this moment. This is a temporary moment. We're going through a little challenge, and we've had some things that have attacked us, but listen, I still have a hope and a future. And I want you to understand, don't allow your vision to become paralyzed in this season. Can I get somebody to help me? God sees you in your situation. He knows what you are going through. He does not intend for this thing, this situation to crush you. He doesn't want this thing to beat you under so bad that you feel like that there is no hope in living. No. The prophet says, do you understand? Do you really have grounds to say that your way is hidden? Be truthful. Even when you survey back, you can see that in times of adversity, God was there. In time of loss, He guided you through. In between meals, He provided. Huh? No wonder the songwriter says God has always stood by my side. In lion's dens, He's there. In fiery furnaces, He's been there. You got to understand, even in Philippian jails, He's been there. And at Red Seas, He's been. What are you talking about this morning? Why my way is hidden from the Lord and the justice due me escapes notice of my God? Your way is hid, your situation has caused you to misconstrue who God is. And so, first of all, don't you develop a misconstrued understanding of God. And then, secondly, don't assume that you know what's next. Huh? Look at verse 28. The prophet comes back. And the prophet says, do you not know? Have you not heard? The everlasting God, the Lord, the creator of the ends of the earth, does not become tired or grow weary. And there is no searching of His understanding. Just when I think that I've got Him figured out, He moves another way. Huh? He is immutable. He's yet the same yesterday, today, and forever. It does not mean that He is bound by operating in the way that He has before. See, when you experience anything, you have the tendency to measure the outcome as to what will occur based on what others have experienced or what someone says will occur, rather than on God's prerogative to move how He desires and how He decides. Don't you assume that you know what is next. You can't assume that how somebody else's situation ended, that yours is going to end that way also. It's according to my faith as to how much I provoke God into blessings. Somebody else may have experienced what I have, but did not recover. The situation never changed. The job did not come through. The circumstance did not change. But by faith, come on, somebody. I need some faith walkers and some faith talkers by faith. That's what you got to be careful. That's why you got to be careful with listening to everybody who knows exactly how God is going to move in this situation. My God, thank God that He reveals things first to the prophets. But when I start talking about God's modus operandi and what God is getting ready to do in my individual life, don't tell me about what He did over or what He didn't do in somebody else. I got faith enough to believe right now. Come on, somebody, get up on your feet at home and decree right now. Give God a shout and say, God, I trust You. I believe You right now. I don't know how this thing is going to turn, but I believe You. Sometimes I just get to a point where I've got to declare, I just don't get it, God. Romans 11:33 says, oh, the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are His judgments and His ways past finding out. That's God is just so big. My God, Isaiah says, listen, that His ways are far above our ways. His thoughts are far above our thoughts. I think that in my flesh, that he ought to do it one way. I saw him do it that way before, and so my assumption is that that's how he's going to work it out again. I already have it in my mind which way God is going to do it, how God is going to turn it. But do you understand? Yeah, don't you ever get to the point that you assume you know what God is going to do. All I know, he's going to do something. I may not understand what, but I'm trusting that he will. Listen, I'm reminded in Matthew chapter number 9, verses 27 through 30, there was a blind man that wanted the Lord to heal his blindness. And Jesus touched him and told him to go and don't speak it to anybody. And then there was another blind man in Mark 8, 22 and 26 where he didn't just touch him, but he rolled up some clay and spit upon it and anointed his eyes and told him to go wash. Now, both of these were miraculously healed, but they were healed in different ways. Can I get somebody to understand that God is not a prepackaged robot automatically programmed to operate the same way? He is the same God, but he doesn't have to operate the same way. Just because he worked it one way for somebody else, he might work it a different way for you. All you know is God worked a miracle, and somebody's decreeing this morning, I need a miracle in my life right now. God's wisdom is too great. I don't get it, but I've just learned to trust him through it all. We talk about trust, and many don't trust God, but we'll put trust in other things. Trust is not trying to prearrange the outcome in your own mind, but trust that the wisdom of God that is so undescribable and has the ability to do it as he sees fit. So you're weary. On the last Sunday, 2020, don't develop a misconstrued understanding of God. And then don't assume that you know what's next. And then the last thing I want to tell you is don't miss the exchange. Oh my God. Don't miss. The prophet says you got to get this. The prophet says you cannot miss the exchange. Verse number 29 says he gives strength to the weary. Come on, vaccine for the weary. He gives strength to the weary, and to him who has no might, he increases power. Oh, God, something ought to be happening to you right now. You ought to sense a quickening in your spirit. He's talking about you. Even verse number 30, he says, even the youth grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly. Now, understand, when what you have been dealing with begins to wear on you and you become weary, you got to make an exchange, and it is an exchange that only you can initiate. The weary that verse 29 reads leads me to believe that God giveth the power to the faint, because the faint recognize the need for what God has and they ask for it. Come on, somebody. You got to initiate it. Matthew 7 through 8 talks about, knock and it shall be open. Ask and it shall be given. Seek and you shall find. You understand, whenever those in the Bible wanted something, they asked Jesus for it. And when you ask, it is prayer. And when you pray, you got to believe. Isn't that right? To ask suggests that by asking, you are making a request because you believe that it shall come to pass. I'm not going to ask if I don't believe it shall come to pass by faith. I'm thinking about the other day, Elijah, about a week or so ago, he always uses, our grandson always uses our phone. And he declares that he is a producer, and he's going to produce film and videos, and he want to upload them to YouTube and all that stuff. So he fills our phones up with his work. And so he finally said the other day, I want a video camera for Christmas. I want a video camera for Christmas and where I can do my own shooting and so forth. And so he asked, he put it in the atmosphere. Somebody say, you got to put it in the atmosphere. He put it in the atmosphere. He said, I want my own video camera. And I heard him on the phone the other day as he was talking to his father. And his father began to query him as to what he wanted for Christmas. And the first thing that Elijah said that he wanted was a video camera. He said, his father said, oh, yeah? How do you know? He said, what are you getting for Christmas? And he said, a video recorder. And his daddy said, well, how do you know you're getting a video recorder? He said, because I asked. Come on, somebody. Is there anybody? If we could just grab childlike faith, that when I put it in the atmosphere, I got faith enough in my father that my father will respond because I initiated what I needed. I wish I could get somebody in here today. So you got to ask. Don't ask now if you don't believe. When you feel yourself fainting and your mic is leaving you, it suggests that you are carrying and bearing too much. I want to tell somebody this morning, you're bearing too much. If you're feeling weary, if you're feeling exhausted, you're bearing too much. You need to exchange your strength in its inadequacy to fulfill for God's strength that has supernatural ability. 1 Peter 5 and 7 says, casting your cares on him because he cares for you. You are trying and not trusting. I'm going to say that again. You're trying and not trusting. We got to start trusting and quit trying in our own flesh. Yeah, when you make the exchange, you will become lighter and you will become freer because you recognize that now the pressure is off because I'm no longer in control. It is now God's responsibility to deal with the situation. And when when we have one who made it possible for this exchange of what is mine for what is his, Jesus, yes, is the one through the Calvary experience, yet that ushered in the possibility for the exchange. So when you feel that you're at that weary place and you're in a weary time, I want you to make the switch. Don't ever think that getting to the weary place can't happen to you. It says even youths grow weary and tired, and vigorous young men stumble badly. It suggests that there is human weariness, and even though you might be young, you are able to go without energy and zeal and zest. But the prophet says that there is the real possibility to be so weary that you lose it. But hold on, there's good news because there's a vaccine for the weary. You are at that point that you have become impatient with the process. And in the midst of the issues of life, you do the unexpected. There is a word in the Hebrew called kwava. And the word kwava means wait. And verse number 31 says, but those who wait for the Lord. And the Amplified said, who expect, who look for, and hope in, will gain new strength and renew their power. They will lift up their wings and rise up close to God, like eagles rising toward the sun. Understand now. So the word this morning, somebody say wait. When you get the meaning of the word wait, you find several definitions. One is to stay in place or remain inactive. That's not the one we're talking about. There's another one that says to hold back in expectation. That's not the one. There's one that says to delay in hopes of a favorable change in or cessation of. That's the one that we're looking for. I'm reminded when I used to love to go down to the country in the summertime to visit and to stay with my grandmother. And I always loved to go fishing with my grandmother and her sisters and all of my cousins. And I recall a time that she had promised to take us fishing. But as we were getting ready to go, it started raining. Now, you would ask, are we going to get to go fishing? And my grandmama would say, yes, we're going, but we just have to wait this storm out. That suggests that when you wait, wait is fitted with hope. Wait is fitted with trust. And wait is fitted with belief that this too will pass. Can I get you to tell everybody in your household that you got to learn how to wait, because this too will pass. When you get to a breaking point, before you throw in the towel, I want to suggest that you corva or you wait. Put off your decision to give up. To corva is to wait. It does not mean inactivity. Yeah, don't go somewhere and sit down defeated. No, understand that your ability and your willingness to corva or to wait is to allow what God is doing with you in transition to take place. And it's all transition. The Israelites were in bondage, and God knew where he was taking them, but they had the tendency to believe that he had forgotten all about them. But I want to encourage somebody this morning that the Bible says there in the 31st verse, he said, but those who wait, on the Lord, who expect, who look for in hope in him, will gain new strength, and renew their power. Do I have anybody? They will lift up their wings and rise up close to God like eagles rising toward the sun. There is a crowd, the prophet says, that has the attitude to go under. In 2020, looking toward 21, there's a crowd out there that's about to try to throw in the towel. But there is another crowd that will say, let me wait and allow my attitude of hope and expectation to cause a new level of attitude. If you are going to a new level in 21, you better learn how to quiva and wait in this last week of 20. And the Bible said, they that wait. Now, I wonder, are you in the right crowd? Yeah, are you in the right crowd? There's a crowd that's trying to give up. But the writer says there's a they crowd. And do I have anybody that can say, I'm a part of the they crowd? This is the crowd that's willing to understand that this is the vaccine for weary people. Yeah, it's not made in a test tube. It's not where you take a shot in the arm, but it comes out of the word of God. They that wait. Now, we don't like to wait, do we? We become impatient in the process because we live in a can't wait world. We feel that waiting is killing time. When you wait, anxiety sets in. You're unsure of what's ahead. Anxiety for they might not understand what could go wrong, or you think about what might go wrong. But when you wait, it's your vaccine. It will destroy all doubt and release new faith. Yes, in the spirit of having to deal with adverse situations. Yeah, this vaccine, you can hope and put your trust in spite of good times turn to bad. You can still hope. Do I have anybody? In spite of aspirations turn to adversity, you can still hope. In spite of opportunities, turn to disappointment, sorrow, and grief that's knocking at your door. I just stopped by the worship today to tell somebody you got to hope. You got to wait because it gives you a chance to renew your strength. It gives you a chance to mount up to higher heights. Though we cannot fly, we can mount up and soar above the swift currents of trouble. We can rise above sadness. We can rise above, misfortune. We can rise above fatigue and frustration that produces weariness. You can mount up with wings. Now understand, the wings of an eagle are very unique. When an eagle mounts up on wings, the inner wing begins to flap up and down in order to catch the air and to help him to begin to rise above the ground. And at some time, the large outer wings move in a circular rotation motion, and that propels him through the air. And this is how he gets above the cloud. And then he begins just to stretch out. Now, understand that the tips of his wings turn themselves upward toward heaven, and he begins to ride through the air. Where are my eagles this morning? Do I have any eagles that's viewing me this morning? Do I have any eagles who are going to know how to wait on the Lord and mount up with wings like eagle? Now, the Israel is suggesting that those, Isaiah suggesting that those who trust in the Lord will be able to rise above petty frustrations. He said, renew your strength. See, this vaccine gives you ability. Now, an eagle has amazing powers of rejuvenation. As it begins to get old, the eagle sheds its old feathers, which are replaced with new feathers, and his ability to take on the wind is restored. Even though he might be 100 years old, he can still step out on the air and rise above. And I just want to tell somebody today that if you're 6 or 100, that if you trust in the Lord, you can mount up on wings like an eagle. Isaiah knew what he was saying, for he used the eagle on purpose. Because listen, every bird with wings cannot soar like an eagle. Am I right? An ostrich is a bird with wings, but an ostrich cannot fly. In times of frustration and difficulty, an ostrich just buries his head in the ground. Isaiah said, mount up with wings like an eagle. A penguin is a bird with wings, but a penguin cannot fly. And when trouble comes, he just waddles in the water to drown himself in his situation. A peacock is a bird with wings, but the peacock cannot fly. It just stands there and looks good. When trouble comes, it can't do anything but look cute. A chicken is a bird with wings, but a chicken cannot fly. When trouble comes, he runs just like chickens do. But Isaiah said, with wings as an eagle, he said, wait and he will renew your strength. Is there anybody this morning who wants to take this vaccine for the weary? Wait on the Lord is the vaccine. The 21st century issues, the COVID-19 issue, all the social injustice issues, and we gotta now take this vaccine and learn how to wait on God. Somebody may be looking good on the outside, but at a sick and tired situation. I don't know about you, but I'm gonna take Isaiah's advice, for God is getting ready to take you to new places. Yeah, we have come to this place where we are weary. But I want to tell somebody to hang on in there, because God sees you in your situation. I know that there is a temptation to give up, but you are at the right time for God. You're at a right time for God to favor you. And I know sometimes that it feels like he is not there. I know you feel like that he has abandoned you. And sometimes you equate what you're going through with whether or not God is right there or not. But can I encourage you this morning that God is Jehovah Shammah. Jehovah Shammah, the Lord is there, is so named because of the manifest presence of the power of God. The presence and the power of God, Jehovah Shammah, is the last Old Testament title of Jehovah. It occurred last in the Old Testament as it deals with God's self-revelation. The word starts out, Jah, the independent one. Jah is shortened for Jehovah, but it's pronounced Yah, and which suggests that he is, as he said to Moses, to tell Pharaoh that I am, has sent you. And so Jehovah was connected with other names. But the name that I'm talking about this morning is Jehovah Shammah. I thank God that he is Jehovah Jireh, our provider. But thank God that he's Jehovah Shammah, because he's right here in your situation. He's Jehovah Shammah, that while you're about to give up, he's saying, mount up with wings like eagle. While you're ready to throw in the towel, he's saying, mount up with wings like eagle. Turn and lift up your wings. He said, be strengthened in the name of Jesus. I wish I could get somebody who would decree that Jehovah Shammah is the one who's right by my side. Jehovah Shammah is walking with me right now. I've become a little weary. I've come down to the end of the year. I've been through hell and high water, but I'm so glad that when I was going through and I didn't feel like he was there, Jehovah Shammah was right by my side. And as a matter of fact, right now, he's right by your side. He walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me that I am his own. And I'm so glad this morning that they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and never faint. Is there anybody this morning who's about to grow weary, but you're grabbing up and making the exchange? My weakness for God's strength. My weakness for God's power. Come on, somebody say yes. Mount up with wings. Tell God thank you. Thank you for being by my side. Thank you for casting my cares. Thank you for doing everything that I need for you to be. The vaccine is wait. Quava. No wait in hopelessness. Don't wait in frustration. Don't wait in fear. But wait in expectation that God in this transition is working in your favor. And that the storm, like my grandmother told me, we're going, but we're going to wait because this storm is going to pass. I want to encourage somebody right now who's at that weary place. This storm is going to pass. This storm, your plans, your vision, the revelation, the things that you've been dreaming about, the place God has promised to you, the storm is going to pass. And because you're taking the vaccine for the weary, that's the word that Isaiah gave to the people in captivity. They understood what it was to have lived in freedom, They understood what it was to have plenty of jobs. They understood what it was to get raises and shop, go about doing whatever it was they wanted to do. But they went into Babylonian captivity because they disobeyed God. And God allowed this thing to happen. I suspect that God has allowed a lot of what's happening today to occur because we have disobeyed God. We've gone after things that he said, don't put your hands on. This world has become so corrupt. Men have decided to go their own ways, and God has allowed some things to happen. I'm not suggesting that God just deliberately sent pestilence, but he said in the Bible it'll happen. You read Matthew 24, these things will come. Earthquakes in diverse places. Volcanoes erupting. Come on, somebody. All kinds of things happen. The diseases. And yet God says, understand, I'm still with you. Maybe we can turn our attention back to God. Maybe we lost our focus and we were carrying too much because we were trying to live life on our own terms. And you got weary. But they that wait upon the Lord, that's the vaccine. This is from God. They shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like an eagle. This is your time. As we prepare to go into 2021, it is our prayer and our hope that we make it. But while we have opportunity now, we need to, on this last Sunday of the year, make the exchange. You maybe have had a misconstrued understanding of who God is. Maybe you've assumed that you knew what was next. And maybe you have not made the exchange. This is a good day on this last Sunday to say, God, you know what? All that we've been through in 2020, on this last Sunday, I'm making an exchange. Because your understanding is unsearchable. Too wise, too great, too omniscient for me. So I need to exchange and cast this to you. I want to say to somebody who feels like God has not been there, he's there. But you got to ask and believe so that you can receive. You've got to initiate the exchange. He's there waiting on you. He's everywhere. But you got to activate the power that he wants to release to your life. The first thing you need is a relationship with him. He loves you. He sent Jesus for you. Whether you have asked for forgiveness and have invited him to your life or not, Jesus died for you. If you have not accepted Christ, listen, we are virtual, but Jesus saves virtually too. You don't have to come and be in this building for Jesus to save you. You need to make that exchange because you have your life in your hands and you will spend eternity somewhere. I know there are many who doubt that, but don't come down to the end because there's no conversion in the grave. You got to make your decision while you have an opportunity. If you are one who needs to be saved, the Bible says that if you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, you shall be saved. Pray this prayer with me. Say, Father, In Jesus' name, I'm a sinner. I'm lost. I'm helpless. I'm condemned without you. Forgive me of all my sin. I invite you into my heart. Save me and bring me into a proper relationship. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to tell you that it's that simple. You just made an exchange. If you pray that prayer, you just made an exchange. Because Jesus came that you might have this life. If you made that exchange, write your name in that comment section. I would love to see so many people saved today. I would love to see so many people write their name and say, on this last Sunday in this year, the last Sunday in December, I'm no longer going to be weary, because my life, if I don't make it, if I leave this earth, my life is good, because I'll spend eternity in the presence of God. Now, I want to say to those who are saved and
if you're looking for dynamic worship, inspirational teaching, and a friendly atmosphere, you can visit us on Sundays at 221 West Bradley Street in Gastonia, North Carolina. For more information about our ministry, you can call 704-865-9016. To order your personal copy of today's message or any other broadcast, please call 704-865-9016 and indicate the broadcast date. Or thank you for tuning in to today's online at www.friendshipgastonianchurch.com. Make sure you join us next week at the same time. And remember, let God take control and let the Spirit flow. Make sure you join us next week at the same time. And remember...